Good morning. Welcome to our Mother's Day service here at Lakewood United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us. Again, we're really sorry that you can't be here in person, but are delighted that you've found us online and are choosing to worship with us. Today is Mother's Day, and we want to wish all of our mothers a very happy day. It's also a bittersweet day because some people have lost their moms and don't get to wish her a happy Mother's Day. And so there is some sadness that accompanies this day, and we want to acknowledge that as well. But we do want to say thanks to God for the women who brought us into the world and who gave us the gift of life. Happy Mother's Day to all of our moms. Will you please join me now in the call to worship? Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life.
Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they will live.
And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die.
In fact, Christ has been raised from the dead,
the first fruits of those who have died. For this perishable body must put on imperishability,
and this mortal body must put on immortality.
Then the saying that is written will be fulfilled:
Death has been swallowed up in victory.
Where, O death, is your victory?
Where, O death, is your sting?"
Please join with us as we sing our opening hymn, "Fairest Lord Jesus." May we bow our heads for prayer. God, how like a mother you are. We give you thanks for our own birth and for the lessons we have learned about your love from our own mothers. We marvel and praise you for the miracle of conception and the birth of babies. And so today we give you thanks and praise for the gift of being human and being alive, for the gift of learning and growing, and for the gift of loving and changing. Today we thank you for those women who loved and nurtured us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our first lesson comes from the small letter known as 1 John, found in the back of the Bible. The letters of John are sometimes confused with the Gospel of John, and I know that can be a little confusing. We have four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and so we have the Gospel of John, and that's the big book. And then towards the back of our Bible are three letters that the Apostle John wrote, and we're reading the first of those letters. So be attentive to the reading of God's Word as it comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we shall be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself, just as he is pure. May God add a blessing to the reading, our hearing, and our understanding of God's holy word. This is the word of life. Thanks be to God. I don't have any children with me for the children's message. We've made a couple of changes this week. As new information comes out, we will continue to modify the things that we do. And we want to each week try and practice the best practices and recommendations that we have. And so if you notice changes from week to week, it's not that we're being wishy-washy. It's more that we are trying to be as careful and safe as we can based on the information. And as new information comes out, we will continue to adapt. But if the children were here, and I really wish they were, because I especially enjoy this time with the children, and many of you have told me the same. When I suggested that perhaps we wouldn't have a children's message, some of you wrote to me in protest and said, "Don't take that away. We love that part of the service." Yeah, I know. I get it. So if the children were here, I'd want to bring their attention to the flowers. And wasn't that a nice addition last week? And we will continue to do that. So members of Lakewood who have signed up, you'll get a call every week asking if you'd like your flowers on display during the worship service. Even though the congregation isn't here, it will be displayed online, and you can pick them up afterwards. So Matt and Emily Killian have purchased flowers, and they did so in honor of Mother's Day. And this is a special day. It's a way of saying thank you to our moms for all of the love that we have received, for giving us the gift of life. And it's important as children that they learn to say thank you. So I might have asked the children, how do you plan to say thank you to your moms? Before you go out in the garden and pick flowers to give to her, you might want to talk to Dad or to another adult and see if it's okay to pick some flowers. Or maybe you could ask Dad to take you to the store, or if he would pick some flowers up. If you didn't go to the store and buy her a card, maybe you could make her one. I know you're probably not seeing this until Sunday. Get out some paper, some markers, some crayons, and make her a Happy Mother's Day card. Probably not going to take Mom to a restaurant. I can almost guarantee that unless you do takeout. Maybe your family would consider making a meal for Mom as a way of saying, hey Mom, for all that you do, why don't you take the day off and let us prepare the meal this time? Maybe you could just give her a hug, wrap your arms around her, give her a kiss and say, Mom, I love you. Of all the gifts that you give your mom, that hug and that kiss may be the most meaningful thing that you give her. And for the adults that are watching, if you still have a mom, make sure that you give her a call today. She's waiting to hear from you. Let's bow our heads and pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for our mothers. Bless them. Bless them, whether they're still here on earth or they are with you in heaven. And this day, may we be sure to show them our appreciation. In the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. The gospel lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of John. Yes, it is another book called John, not one of the letters, but the gospel. I'm in the 14th chapter. I'll be reading verses 1 through 14. This is part of a conversation, part of what scholars call Jesus' discourse with his disciples at the Last Supper. He knows that he's about to be arrested and then tortured and then killed. He knows what's awaiting him, and he offers words of encouragement to the disciples who will remain. They didn't fully understand what he was saying when he was talking to them at table, but after his crucifixion, after his resurrection, then the light bulb went on and these words took on new meaning. I often read this passage at funerals. It speaks to us about the hope that we have in heaven. Hear the word of the Lord. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and you have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. And Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask for anything in my name, and I will do it. Again, may God add a blessing to the reading, our hearing, and our understanding. This is the gospel. Amen. May we pray. O Lord, these are wonderful and profound and mysterious words. Make them clearer to us. I pray, Lord, that through the words that I share, that your spiritual truths will become clear. And so, Lord, I pray that either through me or in spite of me, you will speak to your people. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. I'd like to talk to you this morning about heaven. With all this talk about COVID-19, some of you might be thinking about heaven. I once heard a comedian joke by saying, I noticed in music that there's a highway to hell, but there's only a stairway to heaven. Does that tell us something about the amount of traffic going in the wrong direction? A nod to Led Zeppelin and AC/DC. Oh my, highway to hell, but only a stairway to heaven. Interesting. Seriously, people do think about what happens after we die. Is there a heaven? What will it be like? And will we recognize our friends and family? Quite frankly, the Bible doesn't tell us everything we would like to know about heaven, but it does tell us everything that we need to know. In our gospel lesson, we hear this great promise from Jesus: do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's house. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be where I am. What wonderful words of promise. Hey, now listen. Jesus promised us not just an afterlife, he also promises us a better life. Listen to these words from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, just 2, verse 4 and 5. John the Revelator, John the one who had been granted a vision, comes back and he describes what he saw and what he heard about heaven. And he writes, God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more mourning, no more crying, no more pain, for the old order has passed away. And he who was seated on the throne, whom we know to be Jesus, said, I am making everything new. Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Did you hear that? No more crying. No more sickness, no more death, no more pain, no more tears. Jesus promises us not just an afterlife, but a better life. What's that going to look like exactly? Well, that the Bible does not tell us. In our first lesson this morning from the book 1 John chapter 3, we read, Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we shall be has not yet been made known. The Bible clearly says it's not yet been made known what we will look like, but there's this promise. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. Well, that's an answer, but it's still not everything we might want to know. For those who are anxious about dying, Jesus offers us great comfort. He tells us that when we die, he will come to get us and he will take us to his Father's house. We know that when we see him, we shall be made like him. He offers us not just an afterlife, but a better life. That's good news, don't you think? But how can we be sure? How can we be sure that Jesus will keep his pledge? Do we have any guarantee that his words are more than empty poetry or vain superstition? Dare we set our hopes and our hearts in the hands of a small town Jewish carpenter? Well, the answer lies in a Jerusalem graveyard. Because if Jesus' tomb is empty, then his promises are not. Leave it to the Apostle Paul to put the question to rest. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 23, Paul says, There is an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised as the first fruit of the harvest, and then all who belong to Christ will be raised. Do you hear that? If Christ has been raised, then there is the promise that we too shall share in the resurrection. But how can we be sure? How can we be sure that Christ really was risen from the dead? Paul was writing to the Corinthian community, people who had been schooled in the Greek philosophy of a shadowy, murky afterlife. Yeah, they believed in an afterlife, but it was kind of vague as to what it was going to be. And someone was trying to convince them that corpses couldn't be raised. Not theirs and not Jesus. But Paul. But Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15 that he has at least 500 people who are willing to testify that they have seen Jesus risen from the dead. It's almost as if Paul says, you want witnesses? Fine, I'll provide them. Call them out. Call them out one by one. Let each person who saw the risen Christ say so. But you better pack a lunch and clear your calendar, because more than 500 people are willing to speak up and testify. Do you see Paul's logic? If one person claimed an encounter with the living Jesus after he was crucified on the cross, well, then disregard it. One person, eh. If a dozen people offered testimony, you could chalk it up to mob hysteria. But 50 people? 100 people? 300 people? 500 people? When testimony expands into the hundreds, disbelief becomes belief. Paul knew that not handfuls, but hundreds of eyewitnesses could testify if they were asked. Peter, James, John, the other disciples, the gathering of 500, and Paul himself. They all saw the risen Jesus. They saw him physically alive. They didn't see a phantom. They didn't see a ghost. They saw Jesus in the flesh. And when he appeared, he said to them, "It is I. It is I myself." 500 people. 500 people left a testimony that we need to hear today. It is safe to die. Let me say that again. It is safe to die. So let us live our lives without fear, and let us die with faith. Let us neither fear death nor grieve unduly for those we love, because we know that we will see our loved ones again. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let the church say amen. But wait a minute. Wait a minute. You know, for many people, the promise of heaven is so far off into the future that it holds no relevance for them today. Perhaps one day we might be able to cash in on the promise, claim the inheritance, and slip off into what they call eternal life. But what about right now? What about right now? Well, that is also the promise of Easter. That heaven is not just a future place, but heaven is a new reality which Christ has begun here and now. Therefore, the future is now. Heaven isn't just for when we die. Heaven is breaking into our very lives even as we live. Kind of crazy, huh? The future is happening right now. Because when Christ rose on Easter Day, he shattered the chains that bind us. Christ defeated Satan. And Satan's strongest weapon is the fear of death. Therefore, Jesus has devastated his dominion, setting us free from everything that threatens to destroy us. And so I want to say this morning, heaven can't wait. The doorway to heaven has been opened, and that doorway swings in both directions. It opens out, assuring us that we have a future after we die. But that doorway also opens in so that the kingdom of God may come forth from heaven. The kingdom of God may come from heaven into our lives today. We can't see the shape of who God is creating us to be. But the truth is, God left heaven to be born of a woman so that we could be like God. The kingdom came from over there to be here. The foretaste of the heavenly promise is seen in Christ, and by living in him, we are made new. Listen, we can't wait until we die to start becoming good people. God left heaven so that we can be like him here and now. What we shall be like then has not yet been revealed, but we know that we shall be like him. So in the meantime, we let Christ live in us. We let Christ breathe in us. We let Christ shape us into the people he wants us to be. In surrendering our lives, in dying to our old self, we allow him to shape us into the beautiful people that we're destined to be. You know, when Jesus walked on earth, he spoke very little, occasionally, but not a lot, about heaven in the next world. But he spent a lot of time preaching about the kingdom of heaven now. In Matthew 4, verse 17, Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe." He was telling his followers that the kingdom was coming into their midst and they needed to turn. That's the literal definition of the word repent. They needed to turn and participate in the coming reign of God. Heaven is not just wishful thinking. Heaven is not just pie in the sky and the great by and by. Heaven, according to Jesus, is the kingdom of God which is coming into existence now. And we can choose to participate. What did Jesus mean when he referred to the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven? It's simply this, it's the rule of God, the reign of God that is marked by love and compassion, justice and mercy. Jesus taught his disciples to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Jesus is telling us in the Lord's Prayer that heaven is not just for the afterlife. Heaven can't wait until we die. Heaven needs to start happening right here on earth. And it begins with you and me. What have I been trying to say this morning? Just this. Yes, we have the hope of heaven for when we die. Yes, we have the assurance that we will see our loved ones again. And also this, heaven is trying to break into our world today, and God needs you and me to participate. God needs our help to make it happen. You and I are the hands and the feet and the voice of God in the world. You and I help to inaugurate the reign of God's kingdom based on love and compassion, justice and mercy. We get to tell the good news. Christ has overcome the grave. Be not afraid. Therefore, do the work of the kingdom. Do the work of the kingdom even when it's hard. Do the work of the kingdom even when it doesn't seem to make a difference. Do the work of the kingdom, even when it seems as if evil seems to be winning the day because Christ has overcome the enemy. Even if death should threaten to threaten us in our kingdom work, we know that we have the victory. We know that we have the victory because Christ has overcome the enemy. Do I take precautions because of the coronavirus? You bet I do. As an act of love for my family and loved ones, and also for people I don't even know. Am I afraid to die? I don't want to, but I'm not afraid. Heaven can't wait for us to be good people. Heaven can't wait for us to do the right thing. God wants us and needs us to do the work of the kingdom right here and now. Now listen, the final victory belongs to Jesus Christ. It's not ours to make it all happen. It's His. But we participate. When we shall see the fulfillment of Christ's kingdom, nobody knows. But as we allow Christ to form Himself in each of us, we begin to see the picture more clearly. As Paul wrote so beautifully in 1 Corinthians 13, we see as if in a mirror dimly, but then we shall see face to face. So don't wait until you die to let heaven get into you, because heaven can't wait. Amen.
Story, how my Savior came from glory.
Before we say our prayers this morning, there are several prayer requests that have come our way, and I'd like to lift those up. We've been asked to pray for Ann Conchilla and her family. Lord, hear our prayers. We've been asked to pray for all of our moms and also to remember those families where mom has died and we can't be with her this day. Lord, hear our prayers. I'd like to lift up Jerry Repman. I visited with him in the nursing home yesterday. He's getting very close to the time when he will cross over from this life to the next. And I pray that his transition from this world to the world of glory will be a peaceful one. For Jerry Repman, Lord, hear our prayers. This past week, Libby Gilchrist was admitted to the hospital for some tests. She has since come home, but we do want to keep Libby and her family in our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Linda Lim was also admitted to the hospital for some testing, and we ask your prayers for Linda and also for Errol. So all these folks that are admitted to the hospital are not allowed to have visitors. So loved ones are dropping their family members off at the hospital, and then they've got to get back in the car and go home. And that's very difficult. So prayers for Linda and for Errol. Lord, hear our prayer. We were asked earlier in the week to pray for the Menlo Park VA hospital in New Jersey. There are many who are sick there and without family. And since that first prayer request went out, I'm told that Julia Roussos, one of our members, who is a nurse practitioner, volunteered to go there to assist with the COVID-19 patients. We pray for Julia and all those who are on the front line. They are certainly placing themselves at greater risk by choosing to provide love and care. Those COVID-19 patients, many of whom are placed on ventilators, are not allowed to have family with them. And so oftentimes it falls upon the hospital staff to provide the comfort and the reassurance. So not only are they providing professional duties, but they're also providing compassionate care that family might also provide. So for Julia and for all of those on the front line, Lord, hear our prayer. We also want to remember all those in our congregation who are having birthdays this coming week, and we will now sing Happy Birthday to them. May we pray. O gracious and loving God, we thank you for the gift of life. And we thank you for the beauty and the wonder of creation. In the springtime, we thank you for the multitude of colorful flowers, the return of singing birds, and the greening of grass and trees. All around us, new life speaks to us of your constant, faithful love, and of the reminder of resurrection, that life triumphs over death. On this Sunday, Lord, we thank you for our mothers, especially for the gift of life they gave us. We thank you for all of their tender, loving care over the years, for their patient, listening ear, and for the wisdom they imparted to help us become the people we are today. But we also pray today for those who find this a difficult day for one reason or another. Hear our prayers as we pray for those who are abused or neglected by their mothers. for those women who would like to become mothers but cannot, for those mothers whose lives were shattered by the death of a child at whatever age. They know a pain and a grief unequaled in human experience. For those among us who have lost their mothers in death and who no longer have a mother with whom to celebrate this day. And for those who are hiding secret and painful hurts, perhaps of a child given up for adoption or a child they could not care for who was aborted. O God, on this day that is supposed to be so happy, there are those who carry hurts and sorrows. Be with them this day, we pray. Comfort them, draw near to them, and remind them of your never-failing love. O thou who art the great physician, we pray for any and all who are sick or afflicted. In this time, we especially remember those who have contracted the coronavirus. Lord, both bodily pain and emotional illness diminish us as human beings. We know that wholeness is your desire for each of your children, and anything that prevents us from being the full man or the full woman you intend us to be is opposed to your will. And so we lift up to your care those persons whom we have named and those whom we name silently in our minds now. May your love bring them strength and hope. O Lord, receive the prayers of your people and answer us not in the poverty with which we ask, but according to the riches of your grace and mercy. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. And now, as he taught us, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come now to that place in our service where we receive our morning offering. And once again, I am so very grateful for the faithful stewardship of the people of Lakewood. You have been very faithful to send either by mail or putting it in the mailbox here at church. And your continued generosity is blessing us. We're able to keep our staff. We're able to continue the ministry. We're able to assist others in the community. And the work and the ministry of Jesus Christ continues because of your faithful stewardship. Let us now dedicate to God the morning offering, the gifts we received this past week, and the gifts we will receive in the coming week. Let us pray. O gracious God, like a mother, you love us, tenderly caring for us in our time of need, yet firm with us that we might grow mature. We thank you for your love that abides with us always, and for all that you do, creating, redeeming, and sustaining life. We praise your holy name. Receive now these gifts we bring. Bless them to their intended use, to spread the word of your goodness and love, and to minister in your name to the hurts and the brokenness of this world. Bless gift and giver, those unable to give, and your servants who bear them to this place. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. Please join with me now as we sing our closing hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. Thank you all very much for worshiping with us. It has been a pleasure to come to you through this amazing technology. Once again, we want to give thanks to Jackie and Jeremiah and their family for helping to make these worship services possible. Each of us, using the spiritual gifts that God has given us, we continue to praise the Lord. Happy Mother's Day to all of our moms. Don't forget to wish your mom a happy Mother's Day. Go forth now in the strength, not only knowing that heaven awaits you, but heaven is waiting to get into you. Go in peace.